So Eric, let me jump to the topic that I've said you were going to talk about, which is Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney, we can't count on him doing anything here. Mitt Romney's in the, you know, he's out there whining that he's being swift boated. He's swift bloated is what he is. But this comparison of Mitt Romney being swift boated and what was done to John Kerry, it's a ridiculous comparison.
Yeah, it's way out of bounds. But we're seeing an unhealthy amount of it, of this sort of false equivalency. Chuck Todd, just over the weekend on one of the Sunday shows, saying, you know, sort of joking that Karl Rove should get, you know, royalties on this campaign. It's right out of the 2004 campaign. And he said, you know, explicitly that Obama is swift boating Mitt Romney.
Well, Eric, let me ask you something. You know, in a way, people don't care. I mean, see, the Republicans think that's more important than it really is. Republicans are saying, wow, this is going to be a talking point that people are going to read. People think it's kind of funny. I mean, here you got Karl Rove invented it.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Democrats brought it to hard science, and all of a sudden, the Republicans brought it to hard science, and all of a sudden, the Democrats, somebody with a brain in the Democratic organization has said, hell, let's do it.
There's two separate things. In sort of the very base level, if you want to say swift voting is turning a strength into a weakness, John Kerry was running on the strength of his military service. That was turned into a weakness. Mitt Romney was running on the strength of his business career, turned into a weakness. On that very simple level, if you want to describe, in a way, swift voting that, this has occurred with Romney. But this is a gigantic, you know, but here. Swift vote was built on lies. It was a multi-million dollar coordinated smear campaign that lied about a veteran's military service.
Mm-hmm.
There is nothing even remotely similar to that going on with Mitt Romney and Bain. Legitimate questions about, you know, his employer past, his employment past, are being asked, along with questions about his tax return. This is sort of journalism 101. If you're running for president, people are going to look at your resume, especially if you go around the country saying, look at my resume.
It's called vetting, isn't it? I mean, that's
called vetting. So it's not swift voting if it's true. And journalists should not be so lazy as to use this catchphrase as when a candidate has to answer uncomfortable questions about his past. That's not swift voting. That's campaigning.
Well, you've noticed, I follow you for years. You've always had the same thing that I've had. I come out of journalism school at University of Florida, where journalists had to work. We had to work to get information. It was part of our job to vet. It was, and that was acceptable. Matter of fact, it was demanded. If we didn't do that, we failed out of class. It's what we had to do. But now journalists have gotten to the idea that if they can't get it, if they can't find it, in the next 30 minutes, then it's not a story. Now let me ask you this, Eric: as this develops, here we are, midsummer, we're moving to November. Is this the kind of story that we can keep alive? Is it the kind of story that it seems to build on itself every day? I mean, now Hartman's out front on the Salon.com story. It's a great story. The Salon.com story we're going to talk about today, as a matter of fact, where Mitt Romney goes around and he actually gets money from some of the people that were involved in the thug squads down in South America. And so all of a sudden the Bain money somehow ties up to that. It's not really clear to me. I read the story and you say, okay, well, you don't really have the name, but there are some names surrounding it that make it almost impossible to say that the Bain people could not have known that this is blood money coming out of South America to start Bain Capital. So what I'm saying is, does the story continue to grow?
Well, I think the issue of Bain certainly continues to grow. And again, because this is why Mitt Romney said he's qualified to be president. It's interesting. He doesn't talk about his governorship in Massachusetts. You wouldn't know he was governor of Massachusetts if you listen to the campaign rhetoric, if you listen to his surrogates on television. Virtually all of this is, you know, his job creating. And that's, of course, because of Romney Care in Massachusetts. So much of the campaign is about his, you know, his so-called job creation at Bain. So this is going to be, you know, this is the centerpiece, and I guess the Olympics, that's his big one, too. So and so he put that out there, and he said, this is why I'm qualified to fix the economy and things like that. But again, these are very simple questions that are being asked. When did you stop being CEO? Why were you listed as managing partner, owner, and CEO of a company you didn't oversee? These are not dirty questions. This is not a smear campaign. This is not the Obama campaign getting nasty, which is what, you know, Fox News is whining about. Again, this is campaign 101.
And Eric,
and I do think it. I do think it's harmful, and that's why they react. The sort of right has reacted the way it has.
Well, each cover up, for example, in this story. Now, if I'm looking at the Salon.com story, which is very well done, by the way. I mean, it was really. I mean, it was disclosure that no, we don't have the smoking gun here, but we have asked the people at Bain to please disclose who the people were that put in 40% of the capital from South America. Could they have been involved in the El Salvador hit squads that murdered countless people? And so again, Bain puts up this wall. Same thing with the taxes. Romney puts up the wall. Same thing with the offshore accounts. Romney puts up the wall. In your experience, what does that wall do other than just say, well, hell, it maybe even brings journalism alive a little bit, doesn't it?
Well, I was going to say, and then the real question is, how do journalists respond to this? I mean, if Al Gore were running for president in 2000 and said, I'm not releasing any tax returns, okay, I'll give you 2 years, there would have been he couldn't have survived a week because it's a foolish thing to do, and the press would never allow Hillary Clinton or a Barack Obama or an Al Gore. They would never allow a Democrat to say, oh, you know, you can't look at my private my private life, or you can't look at my tax returns. But with Romney, I think there's a, you know, this question has been on the table since the Republican primaries. It's not a new question. I think the press has been kind of lackadaisical about it. I haven't heard much uproar about it. And even now with Republicans like Bill Kristol and others saying, you know, you really ought to release your tax returns, I think for the last 6 months, Romney has basically been able to keep the press at bay with a declaration that if any Democratic candidate for the White House would have been shredded, absolutely shredded, this idea that I'll give you 2 years where most people give, you know, 10 or 20.
Eric, don't you see the best stories coming out of places? I mean, you know, you count on New York Times for parts of these stories, but ProPublica, Nation, Salon.com, Alternate.
Talking Points Memo.
Yeah,
sure.
Talking Points Memo. That's where these stories are being developed, and it's almost like this sea change taking place in America right now where we're understanding, well, that's where the story is. I mean, I can't see it on, you know, I can't see it on the afternoon mainstream. I can't find it.
Yeah, no, and to this credit, you know, if you go back to the, you know, sort of the birth of the liberal blogosphere and blogging during the Bush years, what liberals did very well and progressives did very well was get right into reporting. They're not just going to sort of, you know, yell at George Bush and say how much they hate him and create these crazy, you know, nonstop attacks the way the right-wing blogs do on a daily basis with Obama. And, you know, he's a Nazi, he's a communist, he's a racist. You know, the left really set its sights on reporting and doing good journalism. And, yes, doing it with an opinion and with an agenda. And I think the fruits are really paying off. If you look at those sites you just mentioned, doing, you know, very solid reporting that's routinely picked up by the mainstream press. And then you compare it to sort of, a joke site like the Breitbart sites, which is sort of Looney Tunesville, and no one takes it seriously, and those stories don't get picked up. So I think it's another example of how liberal and progressives are so far ahead in terms of new media because they take journalism and this stuff seriously.
Eric Boehlert, Media Matters, always keeping us informed. Thanks for joining me, my friend, okay?
Talk to you soon.